Webinar. We'll just wait for Very Worshipful SGL Teddy Calao to join in a few minutes. And we'll be starting our webinar series number 6 for this evening. We're already honored to have the presence of our Most Worshipful Grandmaster, Most Worshipful Agapito Esuan Jr., who will be giving his message later. We're also joined by our Very Worshipful Assistant Grand Secretary, Very Worshipful Oliver Yabut. In a while, we will be starting our session. And thank you all for joining this evening. There are already about, I saw already 90 participants this evening. And I think a number more are joining in. So in a few minutes, we will be discussing the Masonic liturgy, the roots and genealogy of Philippine Masonic ritual. And this is another exciting evening. Rest assured that you will be moved while you're on your chair, listening to the craft ritual work in regular Freemasonry, the craft ritual work of Filipino Freemasons, and the craft ritual work in the Grand Lodge of the Philippines as a regular Masonic jurisdiction. So please stay put, wait a while, and we'll be starting the webinar in a few minutes. Just some housekeeping. For those who would like to send messages, use the chat, okay? So just say hi and good evening, whatever, use the chat portal. For those who would like to send messages, please use the Q&A, okay? The Q&A button is also on the bottom side. Please send your questions there. So later on after the webinar, Very Worshipful SGL will be able to reply to your queries. Again, there are no secrets here. This will be another lively evening. So we open this webinar to everybody, just so we will be able to not only educate ourselves, but the communities where we are as well. Okay. To each and everyone, again, a pleasant evening. Please wait for a few more minutes. And I think Very Worshipful Teddy is working on his technical connections. Okay. Thank you. Via live by our very capable cable tow team headed by our editor-in-chief Harold and together with his team Very Worshipful Alberto Dumlao and who are doing the and Anthony Tan who are doing the transmission of this webinar, and they will also be passing on here queries that are being posted in our Facebook Live. You know? So to all of you who are here, thank you again for joining this webinar. In a few minutes, I already talked to Very Worshipful Teddy Calao. He got stuck in a very bad traffic in Metro Manila this evening. I don't know what's happening in Metro Manila. But anyway, he said he's already in the ramp going inside his unit. So he will be like signing in a few minutes. Anyway, we have a allotted like 15 minutes prior to starting all these things from the call time. Again, to all of you, a pleasant evening. Thank you for joining us. For those who are in Metro Manila, and especially those who are having their lodge meetings at the Grand Lodge, by the way, we will be inaugurating already those meeting lodges at the fourth floor of the Grand Lodge. So this Friday. So if you are one of those brethren who have meetings inside the meeting halls, you should be there on Friday. Okay. And Friday is one nice day for all of us because it's the birthday of our very own most worshipful grandmaster. So baka mamaya kakanta tayo lahat ng happy birthday song, okay? We've reached the 100 already. So we're like 106 already in this webinar. 107, as I was saying. Please stay put and wait a while. Our speaker for this evening, our SGL, Very Worshipful Teddy Calaw, is signing in, working on his connection. So in a few minutes, we will be starting the webinar. Again, this is also being simultaneously telecast by live on Facebook, being handled and administered by our very competent cable tow team, okay, headed by its editor-in-chief, Kuya Harold, and his editorial group. Okay, thank you very much for all your support. So in a few minutes, we'll be starting the webinar. Thank you. Again, brethren, for those who just joined in and guessed, we're like already 120. Oh my goodness, so a lot of people are joining in. We're already 120 in this webinar this evening. We're just waiting for our senior grand lecturer, Very Worshipful Teddy Calaw, to work on his connections, and he'll be joining us in a few minutes. This evening is another exciting evening. Again, the topic is about Masonic liturgy, the roots and genealogy of Philippine Masonic ritual. It will be an exciting evening again, okay? So to all everyone, you can see already our Grandmaster waiting for us. He's already there, positioned at the Grand Lodge, ready to deliver his message to all of us this evening. So in a few minutes, most worshipful sir, and to all brethren, in a few minutes, we'll be starting the lecture series, the webinar. As soon as Very Worshipful Teddy Calaw gets to sign in. And you know, I think this is the trend nowadays because of the heavy use of internet in the country. I think, you know, providers are having some heydays of challenges and problems. good thing today, converges back to business, and we can have this webinar. Otherwise we'll be having some terrible problems. Again, to remind everyone, if you want to say hi and any message to everybody or to anyone who is in this webinar, just use the chat. Okay, so that way we can greet each other and say hi and good evening. And if you have any questions, use the Q&A. Okay, so questions will be at the Q&A. While we're doing the polling, just answer through the poll site. You don't need to answer through the Q&A or through the chat. Through the poll site, we will already get it. Okay, and then we'll be sharing it. Again, to everyone, nice evening. Thank you very much for joining. In a few minutes, we will be starting our webinar series 6. Imagine, my goodness, this is already our 6th webinar. Caused about by the pandemic, and this is one project of our most worshipful grandmaster, which he wanted to share to everyone and to the brethren who could not go out and were having some challenges going out because of this medical pandemic that we're being faced with. And it's been very, very successful so far, because not only a few number of brethren are joining, but you know, a big number of brethren are joining from Luzon, Visayas to Mindanao. So I salute you all for continuously working on your travels for learning, you know, in our craft. Right now, there are like about 130 already, my goodness, you know, around 130 who are already in this webinar. And I think more are coming in and trying to join. Again, to each and everyone out there, brethren, please stay safe and be well, you know. And if you are already attending stated meetings, just make sure you are following the required medical protocols, you know, that are in place, especially in your area. And like the wearing of face mask, face shield, it's better to be safe than sorry, brethren, you know. We love to see you, but at the same time, we also want you to be safe, okay? And this is one of the things that we were opening, the Grand Master decided to open the Grand Lodge, not to like welcome the virus, but to make sure that we will be able to care well among each other. Okay? So that's the sense why it was open. We wanted to have a venue to check and to be sure that everyone is doing well. Hindi po ako nagle-lecture, by the way. Baka magtaka kayo, kala nyo lecture na to. Sinesegue ko lang po yung pagpasok ni very worshipful Teddy Calaw. Baka pag hininto ko po itong segue, eh baka kala nyo tapos na po ang kanyang lecture. Oh, there's a message here, most worshipful. Baka mamaya masagutun nyo to. Sabi ni, I hope this webinar will continue even in the end of this pandemic. This is for those brethren who are tied up for work in the country and have no chance to attend a lodge for lecture. Ah, yes, kuya, don't worry. I think with what we've done, most likely, even after the term of most worshipful Agapito S1 Jr., this will be institutionalized, because it got a good review, not only from those who are attending it, but also from a lot of those who have heard about it and started joining it. Okay? So we didn't expect this to be this much. We were just hoping that we provide a good venue for everybody to have a way of continuing, you know, with their learning and growth within the craft in our own humble little way of sharing. And it's like a successful undertaking that is being worked out. So, you know, we're just on our, remember, we're just in November. We're just on our sixth of a series, which we started in June. So we still have December, January, February, March, April, 5 more. Five more lectures, don't worry. In December, it will be exciting as well, because in December we'll be discussing the Masonic jurisprudence. Wow. This will be about Most Worshipful Suan's ethics, a guided tour. So brethren, most likely this will be titled Yeah, okay. And we will be discussing all the edicts that were issued during the time of our Most Merciful Grand Master. This is in December, December 16th, okay? And then by January of 2021, we'll be discussing about lodge management. So lodge management will be about Masonic harmony and mediation skills, okay? Yeah. You know, a lot of lodges akala meeting lang yon, no, stated meetings, no? But we also discuss more about Masonic harmony and mediation skills, because there are like some small conflicts, you know, that are happening at the lodge level that need that have to reach the Grand Lodge, okay? So at that stage you can already handle it, so we're working on that. And then next is February, we'll have Masonic history. Masonic history will be where we'll be discussing when fake news mask his Masonic history, addressing the sources of false allegations about the craft. This is another exciting topic. And then by March, we'll have Masonic philosophy, seeking Masonic light, pointers of doing personal Masonic research. And then April, before the targeted annual communication, still we'll be having one last discussion about Masonic liturgy again, but this one will be about deeper and richer in time, how the ritual systems of appendant bodies enhance the craft. Okay, so this is now a broader perspective of what we'll be discussing this evening. Okay, in a few minutes, wait, there's one attendee who is raising his hand. Okay. Pinagtataas ng kamay. Koyang Ramoncito. Karanza, are you raising your hand? Talaga, I will allow you to talk. Sige, para habang nag-aantay tayo kay... Ayaw. Okay. Okay, aside from our viewers here who already reached about 145, we also have 145 live viewers on Facebook and Cable Tow page. My goodness, good evening. Thank you very much. Thank you for joining us, okay? So we're having like about 290 brethren who are already, you know, online. And then, wait, Kuya Teddy's calling me. Excuse me.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Good, Eddie. Oh. Parang may uniform tayo, ah.
Okay. Switchables here, not yet.
Nandito na.
My other app will now be the will be for the screen. Huh?
Yeah, can you send it? Can you put it up now so I can make it a co-host?
Yeah. Did you put in the poll questions?
Yes.
Okay.
So this one will be.
Okay, I'll shut this down.
Co-host.
Wait lang. I'll change this name para ano. Yeah.
Which one will you use? This one?
Wait lang. Yung
pangalawa?
Itong Teddy Kalaw. Ito, the one I'm gonna change now. That's, make the other one the co-host, please. Not this Teddy Kalaw account.
Okay.
Because that's the...
Okay.
Here we go.
Okay. I think we're good. Wait, quit, Eddie.
Wait, we'll have most worshipful first, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay na ako.
Okay. Again.
7:25.
Good evening, brethren and guests for joining this sixth webinar series that the Grand Lodge of the Philippines has been conducting since the whole jurisdiction went under pandemic, you know. We're very lucky that our grandmaster is proactive, you know, in the way he thinks and the way he attends to things. So he said, let's not be idle, let's do something for the brethren, even if they're in their respective houses. So we're doing this webinar series for all of you brethren and for others who would like to have an idea of what the craft is all about. This evening, we're very lucky to have our most worshipful grandmaster, of course, and then we have very worshipful Assistant Grand Secretary Oliver Yabut and our Senior Grand Lecturer, Very Worshipful Teddy Kalam, okay, who will be doing the lecture later on. So, without much further ado, okay, I know you've all been looking forward to hear his message this evening because every month, yung balita na yun, sigurado yun ang pinagkakaguluhan at nagte-trending, you know. After he says his piece this evening, trending yan sigurado for the next, you know, days and weeks, you know, in the Grand Lodge, in the jurisdiction. So everybody's very excited to hear the message this evening. By the way, it will be his birthday on Friday, okay? So, but alam nyo, tingnan nyo naman, birthday ni Grandmaster natin, tayo pa rin ang inisip niya. So again, it is my honor and privilege to introduce the Grand Master of the Most Worshipful Grand Lodge of PNX Reservations of the Philippines, Most Worshipful Agapito Esuan Jr. Sir?
Thank you very much, Very Worshipful Dennis. Very Worshipful Teddy Kalaw, our indefatigable Senior Grand Lecturer, the man of the hour. Very Worshipful Dennis Kunanan, our Chief of Staff. Very Worshipful Oliver Yabut, our Assistant Grand Secretary. My dear brethren, good evening. Let me first greet one and all a safe and healthy day. As you know, Freemasonry has faithfully observed restrictions on gathering since the declaration of the pandemic, but we have not been idle. The Grand Lodge remained open. We presided over a number of Masonic ceremonies. Several lodge issues were resolved, and this past month, we were able to pay collective homage to our departed brethren, many of whom just passed recently on account of the pandemic. In the grounds, I have opened up the Grand Lodge premises to conduct bloodletting drives organized by Masons and used the GLP as collection point for COVID necessities such as face masks, face shields, alcohol, and other such items. We do not stop our business. Even as I speak, workers are busily finishing renovations to three important lodge halls in the Grand Lodge of the Philippines, and they will be inaugurated this coming Friday. I am honored to say that these temples were completed by the support and cooperation of many brethren who shared time, money, and effort to turn these worn and dated halls into Masonic temples of great strength and beauty, which all Masons could be proud of. You will also note that I have issued a number of edicts and circulars during the extended term, but mostly they are COVID-related measures. We have canceled lodge elections this year. We have extended the term of the incumbent lodge officers up to December next year. We have set up electronic means for all lodges so that all filings of documents and payments can now be done online. And effective this month, we allowed optional opening of lodges based on 30% of seating capacity. We have resumed business. First, so that lodges can conduct their primary task of producing worthy and well-qualified Masons. Second, online meetings, while very, very important, are not recognized as stated meetings. Lodges need to open in due and ancient form in order to legally transact business. Third, the essence of Freemasonry is personal interaction. It requires meeting your brothers face to face and feeling the warmth of fraternal bond flow from one brother to another. It is a shared experience, a shared obligation actualized by our 5 points of fellowship. And the joy and beauty of Freemasonry is expressed through the 5 senses. And we have proven that we can do this while under strict health protocols. And lastly, with the resumption of business, the charity of Masons should go on without let up, more so in the aftermath of the devastating flood all over Luzon. While there are Masons who were affected, they can be taken care of by our standby calamity fund. It is the victims outside who desperately need our help. I have noted some Masonic lodges and districts already doing charity works in badly hit areas, and we need to continue this on a large scale. It is really terrible to feel that while we can sleep soundly, there are families whose houses were destroyed and are forced to sleep in cramped spaces or forced to sleep outside, exposed to the elements. They are without food, clothing, shelter, and with no livelihood, and rely only outside help to survive until they regain normalcy. Let us give them hope and help restore peace to their troubled minds. Let us realize that it is now the business of those of us who escaped the brunt of nature's fury to ease the burden of victims who suffer by the thousands. I have just issued a circular for Masonic relief. I call on Masons here and abroad, the DDGMs and masters of lodges, to mobilize their brethren and organize needed reliefs. I call on appendant bodies, clubs, and associations to pitch in. I call on brethren from the Visayas and Mindanao to return the favor extended by people from Luzon when they faced a similar tragedy. Let us all stand up and be counted and contribute whatever we can, no matter how humble. No help is too small. As Brother Charles Dickens said, no one is useless in this world who help ease the burden of another. Brethren, hope springs eternal in the human breast, and we brothers of the mystic tie should remain optimistic that the present tragedies that we face will soon pass. Our resilience as Filipinos is severely being tested, and we have proven time and again that as a nation, we can rise up after each beating through mutual help. And to help the distressed is a duty incumbent on all men, particularly on us Masons. And so let us remain physically connected, and let us further strengthen our fraternity by resuming all our worthy tasks. Thank you, brethren, and may the great architect of the universe bless and protect us all.
Thank you very much, Most Worshipful Grandmaster. I think your message have been well received by the brethren, and rest assured, I've already seen a lot of brethren and organizations and appointed bodies working on your call, you know, to support those who were affected by the recent calamity. Okay, without much further ado, again, we've been waiting for this night to commence, and as we have started already, the ball rolling with the very eloquent and very passionate message of our Most Worshipful Grandmaster, Most Worshipful Agapito Eson Jr., we now shift to our very competent and rockstar lecturer, our very own senior grand lecturer, Very Worshipful Teodoro Calao Teddy the Fourth. Sir?
Thank you, Very Worshipful Dennis.
Can
you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Can you hear me? Yeah. Good. Thank you, Very Worshipful Dennis. And good evening, Most Worshipful Sir. I was beaten to the greeting by Most Worshipful Dennis, but we will come back to you later in the presentation. I also have a special shout out for a certain group of brethren whose time zone now is 10:30 in the evening. If you're watching, you'd want to stay up to midnight to watch this presentation. To everyone, good evening, good afternoon, and good morning to all of our brethren and guests here in the Philippines and around the world. Welcome to the final episode of part one of our webinar series. We went through all of the traditional topics of our Institute of Masonic Education, and this final one constitutes the last one of the series before we do another cycle of the next topics on the same themes. This one is particularly tricky because normally we're very private as to ritual. So there's a lot here for brethren who know this, who are already Master Masons. There's a lot here that's really just the tip of the iceberg. But even as you will see, even if it's the tip of the iceberg, there's a lot to know. What are we going to take up today? Well, essentially four things to this evening. As we focus on the discipline of Masonic liturgy. And the first is, why is liturgy so important? We'll be looking at the core of craft ritual in regular Freemasonry in terms of, first, its origin, where it came from, why it's important to us, and then we'll look at the core elements of all of rituals that constitutions across the world, whether it's England, the United Kingdom, Scotland, the United States, the 51 Grand Lodges, the states and the District of Columbia in the United States, or here, we look at the core elements of each ritual, and then the modes of adoption, and why we, as all Masons know, there's a preference against innovation. And then we'll go specifically to the Philippines. For those of you who don't know or weren't present in June when we talked about Freemasonry being Filipino, before being a regular Masonic jurisdiction, we were a continental one. And so we're going to look at how the craft ritual work of continental Freemasons facilitated the formation of our national identity. And then we're going to look at the ritual we use now, the origins, development, and the prospective future of our ritual going forward since the fusion of 1917 when Filipino and American Masons got together and Freemasonry was truly established as a regular jurisdiction here in the country and its external territories. And finally, we're going to look at really the central foundation, the cornerstone of ritual, and that is the Masonic obligation. And we're going to discuss why it's important and how you can apply it in your daily life. Okay? Again, this is, I want to highlight, the most private of all disciplines when it comes to Masonic education. So there's a lot here, because this is open to the public, there's a lot here that I cannot touch because, as we say, corny naman kung mag, you know, it's gonna be a spoiler if I tell you already what the ritual is about fully, right? For those of you who have not entered the craft yet, it's important that you learn it properly by going through it. There's no such thing as, you know, there's we have a lot of outsiders who wanna judge us and think that we're this or that, but they've never gone through the ritual. And frankly, you're only truly a Freemason once you've gone through the ritual, because there's so many things that you can't just read about or discuss. It is experiential in character, right? So having said such, at the end of this webinar, obviously, I will repeat my caveat, you will not be an expert on Masonic liturgy after this session. However, I hope whether if you're a brother, you will get to appreciate our ritual more and use it in your daily life, particularly the Masonic obligation. And if you're an outsider, you're thinking of entering, hopefully when you go, if you're accepted and you go through it, this will allow you to better understand it as you experience our philosophy. Okay? So, let's go to the concept of ritual in regular Freemasonry. And for that, I really have to talk about four things. Where did it come from? And what's the point? Why do we call it ritual? Why do we call it liturgy? What's the point? So we'll discuss that. And then we'll go into examining its core elements. And then highlight that, you know, ritual is not the same in all jurisdictions. In the Philippines, we have what you call a uniform jurisdiction. Same with many or most U.S. jurisdictions. But that's not the case in England. That's not the case in Scotland. It's almost not the case for the Irish Constitution. They have an official liturgy, but it's not enforced the way we do it through a what we call a corps of grand lecturers or inspectors in other jurisdictions. And so we're going to look at why. Why is it that in some jurisdictions, You must have uniform ritual and in others you don't? It's very important because we have universally, and this applies to all jurisdictions that are regular, a preference against changing it. Okay? When you're doing ritual, you cannot add something that you feel, you like to add to make it more dramatic or to put in your preferential style. No. That's what we call the legend of permanence. But then you're going to ask, if there's this legend of permanence, by that we mean a preference against innovation, how come many jurisdictions have a uniform or authorized ritual and others, like the Mother Grand Lodge of the world, the United Grand Lodge of England, they only have what you call authorized versions depending on the lodge? So we'll go into that later. But first, what is ritual? Okay. When the fraternity moved from being operative to speculative, from being primarily made up of Masons who work on houses, buildings, cathedrals, bridge works, to Masons who were using the lessons that are taught between fellow craft and apprentice, and using that to evolve a philosophy, to develop oneself, the way to develop that was through instruction in the ritual. And that is why between 1717, that is the founding of what is today the United Grand Lodge of England, and 1738, the two-degree system that operative Masons had. You had fellow crafts teaching entered apprentices, okay, in the operative, how to be a stone mason, evolved into a three-degree system. The leading advocates whom are, you can see here in this slide, the middle one, the middle picture is the Reverend James Anderson, and the upper picture is the Reverend Jean Desiglier. Both of these ministers were leading advocates for changing the ritual, and you can see in Anderson's constitutions the reason why. They were part of a movement called the Enlightenment. They were co-founders of the royalty, which seeks to push a more rational approach, not just to policy in government and policy as it, public policy, it affects daily life, but also in the way we think. And that movement subsequently greatly caused the creation of the ritual that moved from a two-degree system to a three-degree for reasons that we will see later when we look at the core elements, okay? The UEGLE, as I highlighted in previous lectures, split between the moderns, those who established the Grand Lodge in 1717 and who focused on the three craft degrees, entered apprentice, fellow craft, and master mason, and the ancients, who also wanted to highlight what an appendant body here that we call the Royal Arch, also wanted to highlight the Royal Arch degree. So when the UGLE became unified in 1813, they highlighted that yes, there was free masonry in the craft system, basically involves 3 degrees, but it also includes the Royal Arch. Here's the thing. When they unified in UGLE, okay, because they wanted to keep the ritual private, to avoid, what we now term as copyright infringers, because he wanted to keep the ritual private for those entering so that they can experience it fully and avoid at present, you know, what you can do if you want to see a movie ahead, you go to www.themoviespoiler.com and you figure out what the plot is, so you discuss about it. So, you know, at those times, what they wanted to do to avoid that was they prohibited, and up to now, they prohibited the transmission of it in writing. So from 1813, okay, when they got together and a lodge of improvement was established to orally transmit this, the only way to transmit ritual going forward, okay, was through this Lodge of Improvements, because the Lodge of Reconciliation that used together rituals of the modern and the ancient, the actual body of that ritual could only provide taught oral. And that is why if you look at this text here, let's wait for the screen to change. If you see here, this is the text of what we call one version of English ritual, called emulation ritual. There are other versions that attempt to capture the oral tradition. But of course, they differ because over time, you know, memory falters. What the United Grand Lodge of England does is highlight that there, within a set framework, you can have several rituals. Emulation working, which is the most popular now, was first published in 1969. So that's why in England, ritual, different lodges have different rituals. And that's also the case in Scotland. Scottish lodges were existing before there was a Grand Lodge.
So, the rituals that they use, okay, were the rituals that were in effect until they unified, right? Needless to state, when you bring Freemasonry abroad, and when you go to America, Masonic lecturers became necessary because the ritual is incredibly intricate. It's very complex. It's very difficult to memorize. And therefore, they really had to be experts who knew all of this and bring it to each state as lodges were created, and later for each state, grand lodges were created. So we can see from the development of ritual that it serves three fundamental purposes. And you can see that in this screen. When you dip into the ritual, D-I-P, you are dipping into it because it involves three core functions. The first is definition. We can't just have, when we talk about Masonic philosophy, we have to have a starting point, okay? A definitive body that says, this is Masonic philosophy. If not, anybody can claim what Masonic philosophy is. Right? So the ritual captures that. It serves as a repository for what are the fundamental principles and teachings of Masonic philosophy. It defines the foundation so that, secondly, it can be instructed. Now, instruction is where interpretation happens. Okay? And in order to make sure that those who adhere to the philosophy are solid in their moorings of what is definitive about Freemasonry, when you instruct, you have to do so in memorable and dramatic ways. However, you have to do it in a way that's more or less uniform. Because if you change, you know, if you say one thing and another says another, the instruction will be different. So instruction is all about making it uniform in memorable and dramatic ways so that individually you can practice Freemasonry in your particular context. Because every word in the ritual matters. And changing it, you might end up changing the definition or doing it differently. Instructing it in a manner that's not allowed might create different of interpretation when it comes to practice. In order to avoid that, definition and instruction must be the same. Now, when you apply it individually to your own life, that is when you can contextualize. Take, for example, a very specific phrase in our second degree fellow craft. The phrase is a lot more. If for those of you who remember, it's the worshipful master who says this when he mentions the corn of the wine of refreshment, the corn of nourishment, and the oil of joy, right? Now, all of us who are Filipinos here, Filipino males, there's something that we think about when we think about oil of joy, right? I can tell you that what you're thinking about is indeed an interpretation that is accepted. Okay? But here's the thing. The interpretation now, when you apply it, that's when you have to be careful. Okay? When you say oil of joy, .. clearly, if you think about the entire Masonic philosophy that we teach, you have to do it within a monogamous, faithful relationship. Okay? So be very careful. Okay, the oil of joy, for some of us, while we naturally think it that way, we have to practice it within what our philosophy teaches us. Okay, if not, all of your attengs will be after me for teaching something that is not in accordance with Masonic philosophy. Okay, so when we practice this, okay, it's important that we exercise our mental faculties, particularly rational and ethical thinking, be creative, and practice our memory. Because the ritual is not just a set of principles. It teaches us how to learn. Okay? There is a big body of literature now looking or studying the ritual as a way to improve one's memory. And this, the Oil of Joy episode, is one reason, is one of the phrases that they ended up studying. Over time, if you do this properly, your memory will improve because you're given techniques to learn how to do it because it's such an extensive body. So those are the three fundamental purposes. It defines what Masonic philosophy is, and we have to uniformly instruct this so that everybody will know what definitively what we're teaching. There's no ambiguity, right? And doing so, we learn how to learn. That's practice. And contextualize what we learn in our daily life. So that's the origins and purpose of ritual. And if you go deeper, all ritual in regular constitutions, England, Scotland, all 51 U.S. jurisdictions, all of the different provincial grand, every province of Canada has a separate Grand Lodge, all of them, you know, if you are a regular jurisdiction, you have 10 core elements that are present in your ritual. The first four of those are we refer to as elements of preparation. Okay? Why elements of preparation? Because in order to engage in the craft, in order to learn what the ritual is teaching us, we have to prepare ourselves internally. And that is why we have four elements that we go through. Obviously, I can't tell you what those elements are in detail, but I can give the principles behind them. First, whether we actually do a conferral or not, we must open the lodge in a particular way. Okay? Why is that? Because of the nature of a lodge. A lodge is not a Masonic temple or a Masonic center. Okay? A lodge, as the term is used in Freemasonry, is not the building, but the gathering. The gathering of brethren together to do Masonic work and engage in Masonic discourse. So the opening of a lodge, the way we do it, okay, obviously I cannot discuss how we do it, but the way we do it puts brethren in that contemplative state. Okay? Lodge means not the building, but the gathering. Okay? When brethren do not meet, the temple is just a temple. The lodge room is just a lodge room. When they are together, that is when they are a lodge. Okay? Whether we do the degrees or not, all Masonic meetings must open. That's the first element of preparation. The second element relates now to the conferrals. Okay? That is why this is A and the rest. B1 to B8, okay, that you will see here, they now relate to when the degrees are conferred. Before you actually go through the degrees, whether you're a candidate that will be initiated as an entered apprentice, or you're a brother that is about to go into going to be passed as a fellow crust or raised as a Mason, before you do that, okay, you must go through a substantive examination. Okay? If you're a candidate, for those of you who are thinking of entering our philosophy, you will go through this. In short, what we're saying is, you will be given a last chance to back out. Okay? Because we want to know that if you're going to enter the craft, you must do so voluntarily, freely, and conscientiously. Your own free will and accord, and you've thought about entering. Because in many instances, being a Freemason is not easy. There are many who seek to misunderstand what we do. There are many who, you know, because of politics, it fits their partisan agenda, want to make us as some sort of grand, worldwide, villainous conspiracy. Okay? Not easy being a Freemason. You have an opportunity to back out right before we initiate you, even though we've already balloted you. Okay? It doesn't end there. Okay? To make sure that you indeed are learning what the ritual teaches you, we have what we call catechisms that you have to learn. Catechisms, not in the religious sense, but catechisms in the sense that there is a lecture that you must fully memorize before you move on to the second and third degree. Okay? So, being a Mason is not easy. Okay? That's why, even though you're going through it, you're not just witnessing ritual. You have to engage. Okay? It is so difficult. Well, it's not that difficult if you're really interested. But it is challenging. And there's a reason for that. We want to make sure that you understand what you're going through. Okay? That's a substantive examination. And if you've done that, then you can proceed to conferral. And the conferral starts of any degree, entered apprentice, fellow craft, master mason, it always starts with a formal admission of you, the candidate, or if it's second and third degree, the brother, to your fellow brethren. You're introduced to the work in the degree, and an ecumenical prayer is given, dedicated to you, okay, to mark your transition from a physical to a contemplative state. So the admission there, okay, is especially for you what is done when the lodge is open. When a lodge is open, the brethren are brought from their normal, everyday, happy state to a contemplative state to do Masonic work and engage in Masonic discourse. They're doing that to you now when you are admitted for the conferral. That's what the admission is for. They're preparing you for what is to come. And to prepare you further, once you've gone through that prayer, okay, we have, again, I cannot discuss this in detail. I'm just going to give you the principle. You will go through, and this is just a description. It's much more intricate than this. You will go through what we call a circular journey, which symbolizes you moving towards light, where you get to know yourself better and you get to improve yourself better. And during that journey, it's circular because it highlights the winding path that you must take towards this light. You will be given, as against the earlier substantive examination, summary examinations where you will be asked, do you understand or are you prepared to receive this light? Okay? We call this the perambulation. Many Freemasons ask, bakit perambulation? Why is it that term? It should be a circumambulation because you're going around in circles. Well, this is the word that's stuck in our ritual. Okay? So, the perambulation is important because it highlights that when you begin to go through the ritual, you are embarking on a lifelong journey. That is why among outsiders, we do not call ourselves Freemasons, but fellow travelers. We are all traveling towards the light. If you want to know more about this, the best description that I can give you of somebody who gradually understood this process is the late John Robinson. You try to get this book, A Pilgrim's Path, which discusses his own approach towards Masonic light, him entering into the craft. He became a Freemason after writing this book. After, okay? Not before. Okay? So, essentially, these elements of preparation highlight this lifetime journey of becoming a fellow traveler so that you're prepared for what we call the formation. Your formation in the craft. And there are three elements of formation, okay, which obviously I cannot tell you what they are, right? But I can give you the principles. There are three elements of Masonation that our ritual provides. The first and most significant in terms of being the foundation is a very long list of obligations that you commit yourself to. Okay? So, why commit yourself? Why oblige yourself? Okay? you when you manifest that you oblige yourself, you're obliging your you're making a manifestation to your fellow brethren and to the lodge in particular to develop yourself with your God, your faith, with your God, in terms of the faith that you worship, witnessing that manifestation. What are these obligations? Sorry, you'll have to know that by entering the craft. But they constitute, as you will see later, they constitute the fundamental basis for improving oneself daily outside the lodge. And we'll get to see some of that later towards the end of this presentation. So, after you oblige yourself, the worshipful master now, okay, will demonstrate to you the key symbols, signs, and teachings of this degree. And in the first degree, give you your apron, highlighting its significance. We can't dwell into that now because, like I said, why do you want to spoil this, right? It's when you know, masonry is experiential. You must experience it to truly enjoy and understand it, right? So we're not going to give that now, but we can tell you now that the obligation is expounded symbolically through the working tools and signs that are given to you, that are explained to you, okay? So that eventually, only in the third degree, not the first or second, only in the third degree, you are prepared for a certain dramatic representation that highlights what the symbolical journey. Remember the perambulation? What this lifelong journey is about, okay? It is an instructional climax. Sort of like if you were watching Star Wars, first, second, and third. The third is the one where everything gets put together. Whichever of the trilogy of that you're talking about, the original one, the one that was meant to be episodes 1, 2, and 3, or this decade, the one that's supposed to close out the trilogy of trilogies. Okay, you see that the final film has a similar instructional climax. There is that in the third degree, the Master Mason degree. And this was introduced when we shifted from a 2-degree operative system to 3 degrees. Okay? Can't give you what that is. But if done properly, okay, most brethren, they enjoy this part. We have a multitude of brethren who volunteer for the third degree because it's that dramatic, okay? My advice to you when you go through it is not just be a witness, but, you know, you will be immersed in the dramatic representation. So be involved. Be involved. And know that it is all about teaching you what is fundamental about the craft, okay? So, with that said, you can see that the elements of formation are all about truly being a builder or craftsman. Like operative masons, no. Now, because we are a philosophy about building better men, it's all about becoming, building cathedrals in our hearts. Okay? Because what we want to highlight, and this is regardless of your religion, what we want to highlight is you are God's temple. Okay? You are that temple. Whether you're Protestant, whether you're Jewish, whether you're Muslim, you are symbolic of God's temple. By the way, it's not a coincidence that, you know, Masonic temples are designed to look like, in many instances, classic temples, right? It's not because we want to highlight that you worship there. No. Okay? We want to highlight that we all are temples of God. And what Freemasonry seeks to do is build that temple in our hearts. Okay? This, by the way, is the Philadelphia Masonic Temple. Right? So, from preparation, with the obligation working to send sign, and in the third degree, the dramatic representation. Remember Star Wars, Return of the Jedi? Oh. With these three elements, you come to be formed within the philosophy so that you can now apply it. That leads us to the final three elements of all liturgy. Whether you're in the Philippines, we only have one. Massachusetts, we only have one. Okay. District of Columbia, we only have one. Or you're in UGLE, regardless of, they have several versions. Regardless of the version, the elements are the same. And these last three elements speak about application. The point is not, we demonstrate this to you and that's it. It's personally in your life so that you will become a better man. You will falter many times, but you get up, strive to be better. And how do we do that? Through these three core elements. First, there is a lecture in the degree. Sometimes, many times it's separate from the actual conferral because mahababa, it's long, okay? But the point of the degree lecture is to highlight in practical detail what you just witnessed when you were formed. Okay? So that the elements of formation come to have practical meaning for you. So that's So that's what the degree lecture is about. Okay? When that that may be given separately, but assuming, okay, that it's given to you and you're going to get it during the conferral or separately, the worshipful master then will formally charge you with the degree. Okay? And this charge is important because it's separate from the lecture. The charge is when the candidate or brother is expressly recognized as having gone through that stage. If you remember, I was talking in last month about the stage of going from unconscious incompetence to conscious incompetence as an entered apprentice, to conscious competence as fellow craft, to unconscious competence where, it becomes second nature. The charge symbolically highlights the transition. After you've gone through entered apprentice, then you'll see, oh, okay, now I know how this can help me. So that we move you now to passing as a fellow craft. You start to apply it. And symbolically, when you've gone through that journey of my favorite degree, actually, it's a very rational degree, focuses on the liberal arts, okay? Then symbolically, you're prepared for it to become second nature. The charge at the very end of the conferral impresses the importance of this transition, like a graduation. A graduation, whether it's academic or Masonic, in here we call it a charge, a graduation is not the ending. It is the beginning. When you graduate from a degree, you are beginning to apply that academic degree in life. Same with the charge. The charge is not it's not about the conclusion of what has been demonstrated to you. It's the charge to say, now, apply this in your life. Now, finally, that was a confernal, B1 to B8, that's a conferral. The closing of the lodge now is where the brethren formally conclude their gathering, highlighting to them that now is the time where they can apply these concepts in their daily life. Okay, so what we're trying to signify here, unlike the two previous element groups, is us being brothers and mentors to each other. I've already highlighted last month what it means, that the term brother means. This is really a very perfect form of mentorship. Speaking of which, our master mentor in 2 days' time will be having his birthday. Most worshipful sir, happy birthday. I purposely made sure that this slide was included your picture, because we'll have your birthday in 2 days. So happy birthday to our most senior master mentor in the jurisdiction, Most Worshipful June. Okay, let me highlight how that works in a regular lodge meeting. All lodge meetings, whether you're meeting in the main hall of the United Grand Lodge of England, which can accommodate 1,000 or 2,000, or you're meeting in, this is an actual picture of a lodge in Arizona that has been deemed the smallest lodge room in the world. You can only fit about 9 or 12 brethren in that room, okay? Regardless of whether, how big that gathering is or how small, all meetings are the same. Remember, lodge opening, you open and you close, A and C. All Masonic meetings open, the brethren are gathered so that they can do Masonic work and engage in Masonic discourse. And all lodges are closed uniformly. The brethren, having done their Masonic work, disperse now and apply Masonic light in their daily lives. In between is what you have, the different components of our lodge meetings. Traditional business, minutes, lodge administration, grand lodge matters, lodge projects, balloting for petitioners and affiliate, of course, every December elections. Then, of course, Masonic education, when Grand Lodge lecturers, okay, and lodge lecturers, if the lodge has its own education program, we always promote that, apply the concepts that are taught in the degrees. Okay? After which, traditionally, you have proficiency examinations. That's stage B1, all right? The second stage, the second core element of the craft. So, to your degree, beginning here, before we did the lockdown, beginning this year, pursuant to our latest edict, in order to provide additional safeguards to make sure that conferrals are done properly, okay, we now have a new rule that says that they must be done in special meetings, because not only should they be done properly, but meetings tend to be a bit long, right? Because of the pandemic, there is a circular dispensing with that temporarily. But traditionally, degree conferrals were included in lodge meetings. It's only now recently, to make sure that there's better supervision of them, that without the pandemic, they're required to be in special meetings. Okay. Now, remember my last point, okay, about us being brother mentors to each other. You cannot finish a Masonic meeting. Let's just wait for the slide to come back here. You cannot finish a Masonic meeting without welfare and charity. It is as important as Masonic education, traditional business, because here is where we take care of each other. Okay, we extend charity not just to ourselves but also the greater community. Regular birthday greetings for the month, like the way I'm doing with Most Worshipful June, right? That's important because it highlights our characteristics of being brother mentors to each other. And in a nutshell, that is where ritual fits in Masonic meetings. All ritual, let me highlight, contains in regular Masonic jurisdictions, contains these 10 elements. Except that, different jurisdictions have different strokes to apply them. Why? Because in the UGLE, they wanted to make sure that ritual, as much as possible, be private, because, like I said, corny if you already know it, right? It has much more impact when you experience it, okay? So, in those situations, or like Scotland, where they have lodges that were present before the Grand Lodge. Same with England. Lodges had their own ritual, okay? These jurisdictions are what we call non-uniform, because the lodges took the initiative to instruct themselves in the ritual. When Freemasonry moved to the United States, okay, because ritual was so complex, you had the onset of grand lecturers, Masonic lecturers, who went around and taught the ritual. As a matter of fact, not now, but in that time, because they were so much in demand, they had to do it full time. That's why they had to end up being paid. No Masonic lecturer is paid now. Okay? No Masonic lecturer, regardless of regular jurisdiction, is paid now to instruct the ritual. Although, you know, their expenses are taken care of by the Grand Lodge. Okay? Whether you're uniform or non-uniform, these 10 ritual components are present in the ritual that you use. The only distinction is that primarily in uniform jurisdictions like Massachusetts, California, Philippines, China, and Japan, okay? And you can see here why that's the case. Massachusetts, brethren from Massachusetts founded California. Brethren from California founded the first three lodges of the Grand Lodge of the Philippines. Lodges of the Grand Lodge of the Philippines in China and Japan formed the Grand Lodges of China and Japan. Okay? You can see why these jurisdictions are uniform. Because they developed this system using Masonic lecturers. Over time, this became a core of Grand Lecturers. And they were the ones tasked or charged, as we saw last month, with making sure that ritual stayed the same. Okay, you have a unique setting with Australian Grand Lodges. When Australian Grand Lodges developed, okay, they decided to make things easier for them to have authorized versions. Okay, let's go back. Let me wait for the slide to. Okay, let's go back. Remember the three fundamental purposes: definition, instruction, and practice. What Australia and brethren in India realized was, perhaps in our context, it's easier to do this if we have one uniform, particularly when it comes to definition and instruction. Perhaps it's easier if we have one uniform ritual. That's why India, although it was from English, Scottish and Irish lodges at the Grand Lodge of England of India was established in 1961. In 1965, they decided to go and become a uniform grand jurisdiction like the Philippines, because they felt, given the purposes of ritual, it has to be done. Maybe it facilitates if they are uniform. That's not the case with the UGLE. The most popular rituals, because you know, it's only over time that emulation and stability that rituals were produced. Emulation came about only 1965. It's only over time that rituals were printed, okay, coded rituals. You have many differences. And the Constitution, the actual Masonic law book of UGLE, allows this. The most popular rituals now in the United Grand Lodge of England are emulation and stability. In Scotland, the most popular are Harvey, Standard, Modern, and McBride. Right? So if you're into collecting rituals, brethren, please feel free. You can easily purchase this when you go abroad to the UK. Okay, Ireland is unique in that they have an authorized, but it's not strictly enforced in the sense that they have grand lecturers. They have similarly, they're like in between. They have lodge of instruction or lodge of improvements to teach this ritual. Okay. The Grand Lodge National Francois of France, the one that is recognized as a regular jurisdiction. Okay. Just to highlight, recognizes 6 different types of regular ritual. Please note, all of the 10 components of what makes Masonic ritual in our regular jurisdiction are present in all those 6 rites. Okay? So, ritual use, mode of instruction, enforcement standards, the primary influence for development, all of this, okay? They may be different between uniform and non-uniform, but as to ritual components, that's why it's in red, they're the same. And regardless of what ritual is used, both uniform and non-uniform ritual jurisdictions observe the legend of permanence. They observe and respect this. What is that? I already talked about this previously, last month, as a matter of fact. Okay, the legend of permanence is the principle that Masonic work must be performed without any innovation. Why? This directly impacts the I in the DIP, the purpose of instruction. You must instruct the ritual uniformly. Okay? That's why when you do it, it cannot change. That's what the legend of permanence means. Unfortunately, some brethren here and other jurisdictions, they want to take it wider. They think that ritual has never changed. No, ritual has changed. Okay? We moved from a 2-degree to a 3-degree system in, between 1717 to 1730. And we have other examples of ritual changing when necessary. Okay? Albert, the illustrious Brother Pike, when it comes to the Scottish Rite, an appendant rite, okay? He made extensive revisions to make it more deeply philosophical and make the 33 degrees more they synchronize better, right? In 1986, because of public pressure, the UGLE controversially took out references to physical penalties. These physical penalties references, they're not there because they're going to be done, but they are actually there because they symbolize something. Needless to state, that was controversial and there is a movement to bring it back. In our own jurisdiction, Edict 85, Most Worshipful, Chief Justice Puno, Edict 85 and Edict 251, C, Gabionsa, they allowed for the closing of lodges in ample form. Why? Because we're trying to be practical. There's an installation. You all have your guests there. Okay? You don't want to take your guests out and close the lodge, right? So we allowed ample form. And then 251C, we corrected ritual by highlighting the jewels must be returned. That's 251-C, Gabionsa. So ritual can change, but it can only be changed by approval, confirmation of the brethren at an annual communication. In between annual communication, okay, if there is no strong and compelling reason to seek amendment, okay, you cannot innovate because the second purpose of ritual is uniform instruction. That's the legend of permanence. And that brings us to our first poll. Okay, as we move now into look at our brethren from the past, our brethren who started Freemasonry here in the Philippines. Question, which of the following does not distinguish regular from continental Freemasonry? If you're wondering what that is, we'll talk about that later. But here are your choices. One of these choices is not like the other. Okay? What I want to highlight here is the question is saying, if you, with regards to supposedly these choices, they are different between regular and continental Freemasonry. But one of them is not. What is that? Is it A, belief in a monotheistic deity? Or B, regularity of origin? Or is it C, ethical application of ritual outside the lodge? Or is it D, allowing religious and peace discussion within the lodge? Oh, so for those of you in the webinar, make a good guess. Kuya Dennis, can we have the poll? Okay, what do you think, brethren? We have 176, our usual crowd of those participating. Do not, brethren, you're not being graded, okay? Do not change. You don't have to. It's just a quiz. Okay.
181, we're ready.
Pardon? Very worshipful, Dennis.
We have 181.
Oh, okay. 181, a bit more in this usual. Okay. So we have 41%. Okay, by the way, while the brethren are completing their choice, you might ask, what is 33 degrees? Okay, if you're an outside, okay, or what does that mean? Well, if you want to explore that further, please join our webinar in April 2021 when we talk about the Scottish Rite and other appendant bodies. So that's going to be our webinar right before the annual communication in April of this year. Hopefully, assuming we will have very worshipful Oliver, very worshipful Dennis, and I are praying that we will have that ANCOM so that most worshipful June will not require us to keep going with webinars, which we hope you find interesting because we put a lot of work into this. Oh, very worshipful Dennis.
Pwede na. Pwede di. May bumaboto pa. Sandali.
Okay.
I think when we reach 60%, I think we're good. Okay. We end the poll.
Okay. Let's end the poll. Can you end the poll? Very wishful, Dennis. And let's show the results. Share the results. Okay. Okay. Let's look at the question. Let me define what the question is so that we can understand what the correct answer is. What you're looking at here is which of these four characteristics are shared by regular and continental Freemasons? Is it a belief in a monotheistic deity? Very few of you answered that. And the very few answered it, I'm sorry to say, that's wrong. Continental Freemasons, you will see, because of their emphasis on liberal and humanist ideas, okay? In many instances, that there are continental grand lodges don't require a belief in God, okay? So that's a distinction. If you are a regular Freemason, you must have a belief in a monotheistic deity, not just any god or several gods, okay? But one god, because it highlights your belief in a divine will and a divine plan. Okay? So that's a distinction. Okay? If you're a continental Freemason, you don't have to have that belief. Many grand lodges don't make that optional. Regularity of origin is a characteristic unique for regular grand lodges. Okay? Why? Because there can only be one, what we call the rule of exclusive territorial jurisdiction, and there's going to be one grand lodge in a single jurisdiction, and they all must trace their origins to the United Grand Lodge of England. Continental Freemasons do not follow that rule. That is why you can have several continental jurisdictions, like what you will see. If you were present in June when we talked about Freemasonry being Filipino, brethren here, when they started out, some were in the Grand Oriental Lusitano, and then some were in another Grand Lodge, Grand Oriental de Español. Okay? So that's not the case for continental Freemasons. So there's a distinction there. Now, allowing religious and partisan discussion within the lodge, as you will see, We can't do that as regular Freemasons. But continental Freemasons, that's the point of being a Freemason. Okay? So, for the majority of you answered, I'm sorry to say, and you will see later, that's the wrong answer. Okay? Where does continental and regular Freemasonry share the same ideal? That is the emphasis in applying what you know, the ritual outside the lodge. That's why the ritual, whether you're continental or regular, is important. That's what makes Freemasonry a philosophy for bettering oneself. It's the same philosophy, whether you're regular or continental. But the thing is, those who are continental Masons, okay, it's not just about bettering yourself. Okay, you must be an agent of social change. Okay? So that's what we're going to take up now, because our brethren did start out as regular Freemasons. This is the most probably the most famous picture of Masonic brethren together. You have Jose Rizal, okay? I guess you know he's the one with the overcoat. You have the person in the middle is Marcelo Del Pilar, and the one sitting down, the one who has the, I think the best pose here is Mariano Ponce. All of them, the three of them, are not just co-founders of the propaganda movement. They are also Freemasons. As a matter of fact, the one in the middle, Marcelo Del Pilar, we deem as the founder of Filipino Freemasonry, the father of Filipino Freemasonry, because through Pedro Nolactao, brought organized Filipino Freemasons here in the country. Okay? So, this poll was tricky because it makes you, what we want to do with this poll is make you think, okay, what are the distinctions between regular and continental and others who claim Masonic affiliations? We'll go to that now. Before we go to our of the organization and ritual elements of our origin and how our national identity, some of which I tapped already during the lecture. But first, I hope the poll made you think, ano ba talaga diferensya? Okay? Of Masonic relationship expressly or impliedly, okay, with Masonry, that's why the spectrum of Masonic affiliations, you're basically looking at five unique realities here. As regular Freemasons, we classify them in three ways. Really, you're looking at five realities, okay? Regular Freemasonry are those Grand Lodge, members of Grand Lodges. Regular Freemasons are members of Grand Lodges that comply with UGLE's eight basic principles of Grand Lodge recognition, which we talked about last month. Okay, examples of this are those recognized by the UGLE. You go to the website, it's there, right? Not all of them we already recognize, okay? We have yet to establish Masonic diplomatic relations with the Grand Lodge of Russia, the Grand Lodge of Monaco, the Grand Lodge of Kazakhstan. In due time, we probably will, right? But it takes time, right? UGLE, you know, if you want to know who's a regular, you go to the UGLE's website. And of course, the GLP, we've been around since the first three lodges from the Grand Lodge of California were given permission to form the Grand Lodge of the Philippines in 1912. So these are regular Freemasons. Now, from the perspective of regular Freemasons, we have what we call irregular or clandestines. By that, we basically mean one thing. They are not like us, period. We don't want to be judgmental. We're just saying they are not like us. Okay, and you have to distinguish further when we mean irregular or clandestine Freemasons. Okay, one is those who are co or adherents of co or non-regular Masonry. Who are co-Masons? Essentially, those who apply Masonic principles not just to males but also females. Best example of this is Leroy Human, the mixed Masonry. Okay, regardless of gender, you're in one. You're in one organization, or the two orders of women Freemasons in the UK. Okay, the orders of the Order of Women Freemasons, or second, the Honorable Fraternity of Ancient Freemasons. How does UGLE treat them? Well, of course, for the UGLE, they are irregular or clandestine. They are not recognized, but the UGLE acknowledges their existence because they're trying to apply Freemasonry in their own way. We're not saying we approve of it, but we see the good intent there, right? And then, of course, you have non-regular Principal Grand Lodges that are not regular in origin. This is brought about, as you know, because of the segregation in the United States that caused Black Masons to form their own Grand Lodges. Many times, they were able to trace their warrant to the original lodge of Most Worshipful Prince Hall. which has a warrant directly from the UGLE. If that's the case, they are regular Masonic Grand Lodges as when they are recognized. If they don't have that, if they just form, you know, they're practicing probably the same Prince Hall Freemasonry, but they're not because of the they're not deemed regular because they don't comply with the principle regularity of origin. Okay, they do not comply with that principle. They cannot trace it back to UGLE, right? In 2006, we had a schism, which hopefully we will be resolving eventually in the next decade or so. Brethren went out, chose to be irregular Freemasonry, but hopefully in time, maybe they will see the light and come back to us. These types of brethren, whether they're women or irregular, they are not continental Freemasons. They are not continental Freemasons. As a matter of fact, in 1924, the Gran Logia Nacional de Filipinas was formed by supposedly, we cannot verify because they're not in our universe, supposedly by Continental Grand Lodge in Spain. Okay? So they're not like IGLPI. Okay? And we don't recognize them because for us, they're irregular or clandestine. But that doesn't mean they don't exist. Right? So, what are these continental Freemasons? They are grand lodges that purposely don't comply with UGLE's basic principles because they don't want to, because they have a more liberal and humanist perspective of Masonic philosophy. Okay? So irregular and clandestine are different from those who really are not Masons. No, they're not. But they take aspects of their organization from us, okay? Sometimes in a positive way, like the Odd Fellows. The Odd Fellows are an international order. They're also an international fraternal order. But they were formed because they also call each other brothers. You can also be a Odd Fellow and a Freemason at the same time, by the way. They were formed because primarily to take into account those who did not have other fraternal organizations. Right, the Elks, in a positive way, they also took some of our rituals to form their own unique fraternity. They're usually limited. The Elks are limited only in the United States, the Order of Elks. They only have one lodge, and that's here in the Philippines. They only have one lodge outside the U.S., which is here in the Philippines. Okay. Last century, because of the political... because of the partisan rancor in within the Catholic Church about whether to recognize Freemasons or not, a father who realized that fraternalism can be good, so chose to create an order founded on similar precepts, but with the condition that you must be Catholic to join. Okay. Those are the knights of Columbus. Okay, they're not. They don't claim to be Freemasons. But if you look at their practices, you will see that some of it appear to be borrowed from fraternal organizations. Then you had the Free Gardeners, which were a different set of similar to Freemasonry, but died out. Okay, here. These are associations that copy or use expressly or impliedly some borrow aspects of the fraternity's character or were founded as a reaction to it. Okay? Like the Knights of Columbus. They wanted to have an order that was purely for Catholics only. Nothing wrong with that, right? Okay? So, or they wanted to use the name. There actually is an organization called Chinese Masons, Chinese Freemasons. And when you look at that order, their ritual has nothing to do, seriously, nothing to do with the Freemasonry. But they like the name, so they use Chinese Freemasons. Okay. So they borrow some aspect. So that's why we call them that reality pseudo-Masonry. There's nothing negative about it. It just highlights that some aspect of the fraternalism as established by Freemasonry has been borrowed and brought to that organization. Now, that's different from the truly fake Masonic organizations. Okay? And one that has caused us real problems are Masonic criminal they're not Masonic, but criminal gangs who call themselves Masonic in Italy. If you look at Italian priests, usually they have very negative connotations of Freemasonry because in Italy, there are a lot of criminal gangs who call themselves Masons when they're not. Okay? Even their rituals has nothing to do with Masonry. They just like the idea of being called Freemasons. Lodge P2 is a clear example. Now, these Italian criminal gangs are fake Masons. Now, if you're an outsider, obviously, you might not be able to distinguish, but because they've been around, clearly, we've been hit by these fake Masons. And they're not just Italian, okay? There are a lot of fake Prince Hall Grand Lodges in the U.S., which, you know, give you 180, how many degrees that you want, 99 degrees, it's up to you. Okay? As long as you pay the membership fee. Okay? So, a lot of black bread, a lot of Negroes who feel marginalized, they want to establish some connections. They are led into these fake grand lodges who take advantage of them. Okay? So, these are Masonic frauds. And if you want to know more about this, in February of this of next year, we'll be talking about fake news of this type. Okay, so those are our spectrum of Masonic affiliation. So that now, when we talk about that poll, now you won't be confused. You won't be confused because now you get to realize that there are actually five different realities when you talk about Masonic affiliation, and we as regular Freemasons actually recognize three. Okay, but you have to carve out better what do you mean by irregular clandestine? Okay, or what do you mean by non-Masonic entities? Hopefully, the spectrum will allow you to distinguish. And that allows us now to go back to our brethren, the brethren who went to Spain, okay, and joined continental lodges. Okay, and the first continental lodge of Filipino Freemasons formed by Filipinos. Okay, was formed by the in 1886 under the Gran Oriente de España. Remember the poll? No regularity of origin, no rule of exclusive territorial jurisdiction. Okay, but it died down because they moved from Barcelona to Madrid. In Madrid, they formed under a different Grand Lodge. Okay, Solidaridad Lodge under the Gran Oriente Español. Okay, and this was the Gran Oriente Español that brought Freemasonry to the Philippines by Filipinos, starting with Pedro Serrano Lactao, as instructed by Marcelo del Pilar. You see that these are the Filipinos who imbibed those Masonic ideals that we're going to talk about, okay? They imbibed those Masonic ideals, and unlike in a regular lodge, they could discuss religious and political aspects in the lodge because this was about being not just improving yourself, but improving society directly. Okay? And that is why, in addition to the lodge, they also have a public association to push those ideals and a propaganda arm, La Solidaridad, the newspaper. This Masonic triangle highlights the relationship. Freemasons, Filipino Freemasons, populated these three bodies. Solidaridad Lodge for strategy and education. Okay, the strategy and propaganda campaign as advocated by the Association Hispano-Filipino, and education, the propaganda campaign through a newspaper that was issued fortnightly, La Solaridad. Okay, you can see why this came about. Because unlike regular Freemasonry, okay, continental Freemasonry, and I want to highlight here, the first lodge of Filipinos, what we know as Nilad Lodge number 12, was formed in 1891 because of these continental Freemasons. Okay, continental Freemasons like Rizal, Marcelo del Pilar, Andres Bonifacio, Apolinario Mabini, Emilio Aguinaldo. Okay, why is Emilio Aguinaldo separate? Because these four, they lived and died as continental Freemasons. It was only Emilio Aguinaldo who lived long enough to become a regular Freemason. Freemason. Okay, so all of these four, they're continental Freemasons. And unlike regular Freemasons, there are three distinct characteristics that we don't share today. Okay, first, they encourage the application of Masonic philosophy, not just for individual betterment, but expressly for institutional and social change. That's why ritual highlights this more. Even if regular all of their liberal and humanist belief, there is a de-emphasis in divine will, in a divine plan. Okay? Because they want to promote first humanist and liberal ideals. Now, some who are, you know, religious will contest this, but, you know, the continental Freemasonry, they're more liberal, they're more humanist in character. And needless to state, okay, unlike regular Freemasonry, they don't believe in the principle of regularity of origin. They don't believe in the principle of having one mother grand lodge of the entire world, because they believe in promoting it, being truly inclusive, okay, in terms of approach. That's why you see, unlike us, where there tends to be more and more, as you can see by the grand lodges in Australia, the grand lodges in India, there seems to be a trend in our regular Masonic world towards uniformity. With them, they will always stick to their own ritual, individualized as against standardized, because of this principle of inclusiveness, of not trying to exclude deliberately because of rules other brethren. Okay, so these are the Freemasons who came about and created the Philippine Revolution, as highlighted by Worshipful Brother Emilio Aguinaldo, the 33rd degree. When he became a regular Freemason, he was most involved in the Scottish Rite. Okay, the successful revolution of 1896 was Masonically inspired, Masonically led, and Masonically executed. Okay, our flag, which Worshipful Brother Emilio Aguinaldo designed, reflects our Masonic beliefs. We're possibly one just around the world flag, much to the endless consternation of our critics. It is a Masonically designed flag, starting with the Masonic triangle, starting with the fact that the sun is at the center. Okay, when remember the principle of perambulation, you're journeying towards Masonic light. That's the sun. Okay, and then the three stars, brotherly love, relief, and truth. These are our core principles. That's the flag. Okay, even the tricolors, okay, red, white, and blue. That clearly you will know when you go through and study our ritual. But that flag is Masonically designed because it highlights that our revolution, our quest for national identity, is founded on, it's inspired, led by Masons, and was executed because of the craft. Okay? I cannot emphasize that enough. Philippine Freemasonry is the cultural cornerstone of our society because it integrates the Masonic ideals of continental Freemasonry in our Filipino psyche, what we now call as Filipino, Psikolohiya Filipino. Okay? Through the three foundations of our nationhood. What are those three foundations? First, the unified campaign for reforms that started in Spain. Okay? It was this unified campaign of reforms that they started, okay, to bring, started to unite a colony that was ruled in a united fashion by the Spanish state and the church. And they sought to bring reforms through what we call liberal ideals of public governance, which all continental Freemasons and regular Freemasons share, okay? Except that continental Freemasons really push this as part of being agents of social change. What are these liberal ideals? For which, okay, for which the Catholic Church then opposed. It doesn't now. But this was the reason why the Catholic Church really excommunicated Masons then. I'm not joking. Okay? Why? What are these liberal ideas? The governance of the people through elected representatives. The separation of church and state. The enforcement of fundamental personal freedoms. Freedom of religion. You're free to observe your own religion. I may not believe in your religion, but I'll respect you. Okay? Speech, press, and assembly. The regulation of basic education by the state and not by religious orders. And equality and fraternity of mankind under the law. Sounds familiar? That's our constitution. That's our Bill of Rights. Why is this the case? Because before, our colony was ruled by the marriage of church and state. And these liberal ideas highlight that that is not the case. We might take this for granted now, but this was not the case before. Okay. Finally, most importantly, it was in these lodges. It was in the public association. It was in by reading the newspaper that our Filipino brethren then realized, hey, I'm not just Bulaqueño anymore. I'm not just from Cavite anymore. I am indeed a Filipino. It's then that the first spark, that genuine sense of nationhood, it was given birth within this continental lodge. That is why, if you recall my lecture in June, that is why Freemasonry is being Filipino. Okay? And that leads us, of course, to us being in 1917, merging with our American brethren. Okay? And now being a regular constitution. Right? Which leads us to this second poll. Which is the mother Grand Lodge of the Philippine Constitution? Is it A, the United Grand Lodge of England? B, the Grand Lodge of Scotland? Baka nga ito, kasi it's Scotland, parang mas matagal pa yata kaysa England, di ba? Or is it C, the Grand Lodge of Spain? Or D, the Grand Lodge of California? Which is our mother Grand Lodge? Very worshipful Dennis, can we have our poll? While you're doing the poll, you might ask, you know, all this talk about fake Masons and grand conspiracies like this cartoon here. How did that come about? If you're interested in that, please join us in February 2021 for our webinar on fake news about Freemasonry. Okay. So, unlike poll number one, this should be a simpler. Many of you should know this by heart. We just want to make sure that you indeed know, for those of you who are brethren. For those of you who are guests, interesting fact to highlight. We're finished. Very wishful, Dennis.
Okay, I think we can already. Okay, may boboto pa.
One more minute.
Oh, may boboto pa.
Okay. No worries. 1 minute.
Buwang yung mga iba nag-isip pa, kaya mahabol-habol pa.
mukhang baka feeling like poll one trick question. This looks like a trick question. Okay. Let's see if this is a trick question like poll one.
Okay, we can end the poll now. Okay.
Okay. Here are the results. And now, I am very happy to report that the majority of you, 71%, are indeed correct. Our mother Grand Lodge right now is the Grand Lodge of California. You're going to ask, but the Filipino lodges? The Filipino lodges who joined, starting with Nilad Lodge number 12 up to Bulusan, I think, Lodge number 38. Original that started Grand Lodges of California Lodges. That is why we consider them the Grand Lodge of California. And that is why the United Grand Lodge of England, that's the wrong choice. It is the United Grand Lodge of England is the mother, as you will see later, is the mother Grand Lodge of the world. Okay? Scotland, the Grand Lodge of Scotland came after the Grand Lodge of England, but even though it had lodges before that, much older than the Grand Lodge of England. Okay? And if you're talking about the Grand Lodge of Spain, maybe you're confused. The Grand Lodge of Spain actually has very little part in our history. When we talk of Grand Lodge, you can see in Oriente de Español that formed Gilad Lodge up to Bulusan Lodge number, I think, 38. Okay? Because they got it from the Grand Oriente Español, which is a continental Grand Lodge and not the Grand Lodge of Spain. Okay? So, more on this as we now talk about our modern GLP ritual, which you should be thoroughly familiar with now because you know its purpose, its 10 core elements. Let me just give you a historical timeline of how it was developed and the implications of that. Why we end up, what does that mean? Okay, by the way, if you're wondering why I'm winking here, I'm winking at literally St. Paul's Cathedral. St. Paul's Cathedral is the most beautiful and grandest cathedral in London. It was designed by a fellow Freemason, Sir Christopher Wren. In front, literally in front of that cathedral is an office building. The office building used to be a tavern. In that tavern, the first regular Freemasons met in 1717. That's the historical signage. Okay, so here I'm looking from this signage, you're looking in front of St. Paul's Cathedral. You might want to, brethren, when you visit London, you might want to do as I do so you can get this picture. Okay, so what we'll be discussing now? We'll be discussing how our modern ritual developed and what does it mean to have that modern ritual and what does it look like going forward in terms of how we're going to use it. First of all, I'd like to thank the Grand Lodge of Japan for this graphic. Okay, our ritual today developed because William Preston and Thomas Webb separately, Thomas Swift Webb, again, they're both ministers. They brought their oral understanding of ritual from England with warrants to the United States, and they served as Masonic lecturers. William Preston, in particular, was so good at it that he actually made a small fortune serving us. Legend has it. We can't really verify for a fact, but legend has it that he was so good at it, he made a small fortune from being a Masonic lecturer teaching the ritual. Now, needless to state, you cannot scale up by teaching, right? Because then they didn't have the internet. So over time, they developed their own ritual. First Preston in illustrations and masonry. And Thomas Swift Webb used illustrations of masonry and developed it as the Freemason's Monitor. That is what became the basis of what we call our ritual today. As you can see on top from the Grand Lodge of England and Grand Lodge of Scotland, okay, these are the warrants, the Freemasons using warrants from the Grand Lodge of England and the Grand Lodge of Scotland used warrants from these lodges to form lodges and provincial Grand Lodges, like the Provincial Grand Lodge of North Carolina, which gave birth to the Grand Lodge of North Carolina, okay, which lodges they eventually formed from warrant of the Grand Lodge of England. They formed the Grand Lodge of New England, Grand Lodge of New York, Grand Lodge of Massachusetts. Okay, now, as you know, between 1717 and 1813, there were two English Grand Lodges because the moderns just wanted to have three craft degrees. The ancients said, no, it's three craft degrees and the Royal Ark. Diba? So, that's why if you look at the full title of the Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania, it's Ancient of Free, Ancient, and Accepted Masons. Whereas if you look at the title of the Grand Lodge of Massachusetts, it's Free and Accepted Masons. What's the difference? Because at that time, there were two rival Grand Lodges in England. But that sort of that sorted itself out. And from the Grand Lodge of Massachusetts and the Grand Lodge of the District of Columbia, they all had lodges in California that got together and created the Grand Lodge of California in 1850. It was that Grand Lodge of California that created the three original Grand Lodges, the three lodges who became the three lodges that were the first initial lodges of the Grand Lodge of the Philippines, numbers 1, 2, and 3, starting with Manila, Mount Lebanon today. It was originally Manila Lodge number 1. It merged with Mount Lebanon to become Manila Mount Lebanon number 1. And our own lodges, the Grand Lodge of the Philippines, in 1957, they created the Grand Lodge of China, of Japan, and earlier, they created the Grand Lodge of China. That's why we consider the Grand Lodge of California our mother Grand Lodge. And we consider the what became the United Grand Lodge of England as the mother Grand Lodge of the world. This, in a nutshell, highlights the principle of regularity of origin. And that's important because regularity of origin is the only principle that is not connected to ritual when it comes to the UGLE's 8 basic principles. We discussed this the last month. The 8 basic principles: belief in God, the obligation, which we're going to talk about later, membership being exclusively in males, the craft degrees must be supervised by the Grand Lodge, prohibition from discussing religion and politics within the lodge, avoidance of innovation, the exhibition of the three great lights. 7 of these 8 basic principles relate to our ritual. One that is the regulatory origin I discussed previously. Okay. Now, because we are a regular Grand Lodge, our ritual, therefore, must have those 10 core elements. Okay. Preparation, where we see the craft as a journey. We as fellow travelers. Formation, where we see the craft as a building project. We as builders and craftsmen, artisans. And application, okay, the craft as practice, where we build ourselves together, the cathedrals in our heart, make ourselves a better man as brother mentors. Okay, needless to state, okay, in addition to the ritual and regularity of origin, being a regular Masonic jurisdiction entails compliance with ancient landmarks. What we follow is the 25 highlighted by Most Worshipful Albert Mackey in his Principles of Masonic Law. What are those ancient landmarks in Filipino? Abangan ang susunod ng kabanata. That is our next month's webinar when we go back to Masonic events and discuss this. So, if you want to know what those ancient landmarks are, we'll discuss them right in time for December when we start our second cycle of this webinar series. So that is the implications of what being a regular Masonic jurisdiction is all about. We must have those 10 core elements. And the ritual is the basis for us to be regular in addition to regularity of origin. Okay, as I will highlight next month, it also is significantly impacted in terms of our compliance with the ancient landmarks, which we will see in next month's webinar. That is where we are today. And going into the future, we can see, especially for Brebron, okay, we can see the impact of what being a regular Masonic jurisdiction is. It's the fact, the opportunity that we've had to have brethren abroad who can share our ideals. New York, since 1984, we've had Jose Rizal, number 1172. Manitoba, okay, in Canada. New South Wales, 2020. And in 2011, I'm very honored to be a charter member of Manila Lodge, number 1521. That's their current set of officers. But here's something that's unique, brethren. And this could bode, okay, this could bode for what could happen in the future. Most Worshipful June and I, and I think Most Worshipful June especially, is particularly honored. And we also have to thank Most Worshipful how would you call this? Defense Secretary.
Most Worshipful Bolter Gasmin.
Most Worshipful Bolter Gasmin. Thank you for saving me. Very worshipful then. Most Worshipful Bolter Gasmin for initiating this, which led to our memorandum agreement with the United Grand Lodge of Victoria just in September of last year, wherein for the first time we are allowing the use of GLP ritual in a foreign jurisdiction. This is significant, because while there have been jurisdictions that have allowed the use of non-uniform ritual, like Scotland or England, right? Particularly emulation, okay? This is the first time where you have a uniform jurisdiction like us. They have a uniform required ritual. Grand Lodge of Victoria, United Grand Lodge of Victoria, allowing one lodge to use a uniform ritual, which is the Philippines. Okay, and you're going to ask, how is that possible? Their own lecturers will not have knowledge of that. That is why in the agreement, for those of you who are thinking of joining the Grand Lodge of Lecturers, you might want to take note, the agreement will require the GLP to send annually brethren who will, from our Grand Lodge, core of Grand Lodge of Lecturers, will have a, you know, we will have, we'll make sure that it's equitably distributed, to serve as, to exemplify the work to their grand inspectors so that they can teach it to brethren. And then some of you might ask, those who were outside, but I thought your ritual was supposed to be private. It is. It is private, and it's private among brethren. So they're perfectly welcome to see our ritual just as much as we're welcome to see theirs. That's what happens when you join the regular Masonic world. So this is truly a first in Masonic world. And I thank the brethren now, it's 11:10 p.m. in Melbourne, who are watching. Congratulations again, because you are the first. And hopefully we'll have more lodges of Filipino brethren who are willing to take this experiment and exemplify our ritual abroad. Okay, so hopefully it will continue. That leads us now, brethren, to poll 3. Which of the following correctly identifies the 3 roles of Masonic obligations today? Right? We have highlighted previously that Masonic obligation, okay, the one of the core elements. That's the foundational cornerstone. Now take a guess, for our guests and brethren who have not seen this instruction yet. Can you take a guess as to what are the 3 roles of that cornerstone today, Masonic obligation? Is it A, regulation, instruction, and institutionalization? Wow. Okay, B, instruction, ethics, and mentorship. Or is it C, ethics, mentorship, and advocacy? Or, baka nga ito, D, fellowship, education, and charitable works. What is the point of that core element? A Masonic obligation to our guests is a long manifestation of what you are committed to when you commit to follow the teachings of a particular degree, whether it's first, second, or third. Which of these 4? Okay. And while our brethren are answering, okay, let me highlight, we have many brethren who have Masonic widows because they spend a lot of time in Freemasonry, okay? You have to balance your role, okay? If you want to alleviate or address your Masonic widows, maybe you'd be interested in our January 2021 webinar where we talk about Masonic harmony and mediation. Perhaps you can practice Masonic mediation skills with your real boss, okay? So that's January 2021. Okay. Brethren, this is not a trick question, unlike poll 1, okay? This is pretty straightforward. We're not grading you. Okay, very wishful, Dennis. Are we ready?
Yeah. Just one. Okay. I think
one more minute.
Yeah, there are still brethren who are voting. The percentage is still moving. Once it stops. Okay, we can end the poll now. Share.
Here we go.
You have a tie.
Wow.
You have a tie. Where was the poll?
We have a tie. B and D. And I have like to congratulate the brethren who picked B and D because they're both wrong and you can blame each other for being wrong. Okay? Let me highlight why it's the wrong answer. Okay? B is the wrong answer because ethics is not a specific role of Masonic obligation. It is the point of the Masonic obligation. So B and C, that shouldn't be your answer. Okay? And D, okay, well, there is one part of the three Masonic obligations in the craft degrees highlight charitable works. Okay? Not all of the three highlight this. As a matter of fact, fellowship, education, and charitable works are not roles but activities. Okay? So when we talk about roles, for the brethren who pick, and maybe you figured this out because you attended our multi-district Masonic education last year. If you pick regulation, instruction, and institutionalization, I have to congratulate you because those are indeed the three roles of Freemasonry, which we will discuss now. Okay? What will we discuss as our final topic for evening? The cornerstone of our present craft ritual, which is the Masonic obligation. What is a Masonic obligation again? A manifestation of your commitment to several, it's a very long list, precepts that each degree teaches. I cannot talk about those principles, I cannot talk about those precepts, but I can give you an idea of why they're important. As highlighted by Brother Douglas MacArthur, who is an American general, an American citizen, but he's a Filipino Freemason because he chose to join us, okay? Not any American Grand Lodge. Freemasonry embraces the highest moral laws and will bear the test of any system of ethics or philosophy ever promulgated for the uplift of man. Because of this, the obligation defines how we can live the ethical life. Okay? Teka lang. So what are we talking about here? What's the difference between taking an oath of office, for example, and a Masonic obligation? When you take an oath, whether you know you're taking an oath to become president of the Philippines, when you enter upon that office, or you take an oath to tell the truth in court, okay, what's that? How is that different from an obligation? Major difference. An oath is a solemn appeal to God about the truth of a declaration. You're being a witness, okay, or that you will keep a promise. You're taking in an office and you promise that you will observe. Legally observe everything that is incumbent upon you. That's an oath. An obligation is different. An obligation is a firm and conscious manifestation that one is entering into a binding agreement with another. Who is that other? Let's look about at the distinction between oath and obligation. When it comes to an oath, it is anyone who must rely on that. You swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. That applies to anyone because you're telling, you hope to tell the truth. You swear to become, to faithfully follow, execute the laws of the land as president of the Philippines. That applies to anyone who can take it on you. Okay, but a Masonic obligation specifically is made to the brothers in that lodge that you are committing yourself to. And what does it cover? An oath is the truth of the statement or the promise that you must be kept. A Masonic obligation, however, is a firm commitment as to those specific, that long list that you must memorize. And believe me, you have to memorize it if you're a non-Mason thinking of joining Masonry. You have to memorize it. Firm commitment to follow those principles. Okay? And why is that made? Well, an oath, it demonstrates your credibility. But in obligation, it highlights your commitment to the brethren with your monotheistic deity as your witness. Okay? So an obligation is different from an oath. Why is that the case? We have to look at why it was created. The obligations were brought about from operative masonry. The topmost guy here, that's William Shaw. He was the head of all master masons, not philosophically, but actually in Scotland under the king. And his old charges, the regulations of 1598, provided that, okay, that masons, fellow crafts, and entered apprentices bind themselves with agreement when they join a craft guild. Those are the original Masonic obligations in operative masonry. The Reverend James Anderson, remember him? One of the two leading advocates with the Reverend Desigliers. Reverend James Anderson, okay, when he transformed Freemasonry with others from operative to speculative, used the obligation to define the moral contract of the brother entering into Freemasonry with one's peers. Where can we find that? The charges of Freemasons as contained in Anderson's Constitution of 1728. Okay, you don't have to go to the library for that. In an installation, those charges are read to you, are read to the worshipful master. Okay, so that's to highlight our transformation to a speculative craft. And subsequently, okay, the obligation became the basis for the institutionalization of our fraternity, okay, because they incorporated principles exemplifying the landmarks and the fact that Freemasonry is a social institution. Okay, examples are that are what we're going to learn next month when we go into the landmarks of the Most Worshipful Mackay's 25 principles. Okay, so from these origins and development, we can see obligations today for roles. Okay, first role is that they regulate and mentor entry as a business, particularly when you take the entered apprentice degree. You will see that that obligation is all about regulating and mentoring apprentices. Sort of like the Star Wars trilogy. Okay, George Lucas, you go through his body of work, you get to see so many principles that are the same, you get to suspect that a lot of it is built on principles that you can find, you know, in libraries around the world, right? I don't think George Lucas is a Mason, but very clear, okay? If you go through what he's highlighting in the Jedi Order, so much of it is similar because it fulfills the first role, okay? The second role is highlighted by one of the leading Masonic mystics in that school of Masonic philosophy, Walter Wilmers, okay? Every new apprentice shall find a master for him and from him gain instruction to instruct and practice fellows in the craft, okay? What are the principles and how can you apply them, okay? And the third is to protect our institution, to preserve and protect our institution. So for those of you who are non-Masons who are guests here, what is a Masonic obligation again? It is your manifestation or commitment to observe a very long list of principles and precepts that highlight one of these three, at least one of these three roles. Sometimes two, and sometimes all three. That is why the Masonic obligation, okay, is important, because those three roles are the basis for leading a truly Masonic life, as fully developed in the final Masonic obligation that you take as a Master Mason. You will see the obligation you take as an entered apprentice, it's further developed as a fellow craft. It reaches its full maturity when the longest list you take up, that you memorize, is as a Master Mason. Basically, that long list teaches us a timeless code of conduct that basically teaches three dimensions of being a Freemason. The first of which is building that cathedral in our hearts. Like Most Worshipful Rafael Palma, who is demonstrated here. Okay? Most Worshipful Palma is the one of the first Filipino educators who became the president of the University of the Philippines in 1920s and built that institution. Okay, that's why we have a lodge dedicated to him, who was founded primarily to have alumni join our craft. And we have a Masonic, thanks to brethren of that lodge primarily. We have a statue of Most Worshipful Palma in UP now as a Mason. Okay, and then we have, of course, the preservation and building of the institution that is Freemasonry through servant leadership. The perfect example of that is a Freemason who is not that well recognized today, but is truly is one of our best example of servant leaders. That is Worshipful Brother Tomas del Rosario. Tomas del Rosario College in Bataan is founded in his name. That's because he became a governor of Bataan Province. If you want to know what his singular contribution to Philippine history today is, it is the fact that he was the one who led proponents, many of whom were fellow Masons, in making sure that we have religion in our first constitution, the Malolos Constitution. By the way, in case you don't know, okay, because of our mindset of many Filipino Catholics then, in the Malolos Congress, they also still wanted to have that that principle of having a unified state through making the Roman Catholic religion the official religion of the Philippine state. Needless to state, I'm Catholic. Okay, needless to state, if we had that, we probably would not have the Philippines today that we have, because then you would be making Muslims, you would be making those in the Philippine Independent Church, you would be making Methodists, other Protestants, second-class citizens. Okay? It was through the efforts of Worshipful Brother Del Rosario that they introduced the Freedom of Religion Clause, which won by one vote. And because it won by one vote, we have the Philippines that we have today. A truly secular society where you can believe, worship the way you wish to worship, okay? Still under God, okay? But some society that does not discriminate because you have a different faith, okay? And then third, a practical philosophy for self-betterment over time. This is best symbolized by this very famous statue of George Washington praying, okay? Masons sponsored and built that statue. It highlights that the philosophy must be applied practically. Okay, so to end this lecture for today, let me highlight what those three dimensions mean. Starting with agape, okay? Agape is different from philia. We have our three cardinal principles: truth, brotherly love, and charity. Okay, when we talk of brotherly love, we talk of love that is philia. Love for a brother, love for a peer. Okay, that's different from romantic love, which is eros. Okay, charity is agape, a different kind of love, a love for the other, a love that highlights, okay, the value that you must create for your humanity, for your fellow man, as best exemplified this year by Worshipful Brother, okay, Greg Makasaya. We raised 3 million, by the way, which we are starting to distribute now, because to memorialize brethren like Worshipful Brother Greg Makasayat, who gave his life because of this pandemic, refused to, you know, take a break. He caught the virus, and it claimed him. Needless to state, not all superheroes wear capes. He's a perfect example of agape. Gave his life for others. Okay, that's our first. That is what the obligations teach us. Of course, secondly, they teach us about servant leadership. That is best exemplified in the office of Worshipful Master. We have, as we highlighted last month. Why is the office of Worshipful Master? Why is the office of Grand Master? Why do they have so much power? Because unlike regular institutions, That is meant to highlight that the office is one of inherent trust. The brethren put you there because they inherently trust you. If they don't deserve your trust, you will be expelled from the craft. Okay? It is one which is based on inherent trust and the concept of servant leadership, because at the end, you return to the brethren. Okay? That is the concept of Masonic humility. After you do your service, you return to the brethren. And being a servant leadership means four different kinds of leadership, not just heroic, like most worshipful Abad Santos in giving his life to his country. Okay? When you truly demonstrate your complete fealty to our national allegiance, it can be thoughtful. Okay? The National Library, we have two statues, one to Brother Mabini, the other is Most Worshipful Chudor M. Calao. Okay? You fulfill the duty of informed governance by teaching brethren about, not just about the craft, but also about proper governance and creating value through informed governance. It can be collaborative, either in a public role, like Most Worshipful Quezon. Okay, this is his statue in front of the Provincial Museum of Baler. Or Most Worshipful Quasha, who founded St. Luke's Medical Center. Collaborative. That's the kind of collaborative leadership that we need today, either in public or private life. Or quiet leadership, striving every day to make a difference. And that could include building an institution without fanfare, which today is the largest law firm in the country, Office of Legal Aid. That is the living memorial of Most Worshipful Reynold Fajardo. All of these five grandmasters are exemplars of the different kinds of servant leadership that our Masonic obligations teaches us. Obviously, because it's public, it would be better for me to highlight each precept, no? But I can't do that. You'd have to learn that when you enter Freemasonry. Okay? Finally, how can we do this daily? We won't be perfect. We're not perfect. We won't be like these five grandmasters. We can't exemplify this right away. How can we do it daily? That is the third dimension. The third dimension, like the statue of statue of George Washington praying, is all about practicing Freemasonry daily. Like this, like this example, which you can do 3, 5, or 7 minutes a day. Okay, that is a concept of daily Masonic self-reflection. When you yourself enter that temple in your heart and you ask yourself, one, do you observe like an entered apprentice? What did you commit to do today? And did you actually do it? So that allows you then to assess the day like a fellow craft. Did what you do today align with your own religious beliefs, value system, and duties? Did what you do today create or destroy value? You make that assessment as a fellow craft so that then you can discern like a master mason, okay, using the principles of our craft and teachings of our craft. How did you practice Masonic charity? How did you be a true servant leader, okay, in terms of leading, following, and helping others? So that in the context of what the craft teaches, therefore, you now have the basis for two decisions. What would you have done differently today? And what should you do tomorrow? So, Freemasonry, the obligations tie very practical philosophy for bettering oneself that is directed to the other, that is focused on servant leadership, whether it be heroic, like Most Worshipful Abad Santos, thoughtful, like Most Worshipful Calao, collaborative, like Most Worshipful Quezon in public life, or Most Worshipful Quasha in private life, or quiet, day by day, building your own cathedral that will be your memorial, like Most Worshipful Fajardo. Okay? You can do that. We all can do that if we practice Masonic self-reflection every day. And that is why obligations as a foundation and More significantly, our ritual is the vessel for our Masonic philosophy. Thank you for bearing with me, brethren. This, I know, understand it's quite long, but I hope you found it truly fruitful today. And we're ready to take your questions. Back to you, most very worshipful Dennis. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kuya Teddy. Very enlightening and very informative. I think this evening is, again, one of those successful evenings that we have for this webinar. Okay. We have question and answer, Kuya Teddy. Maybe you can check on the Q&A. So you can answer, browse through them. We only have 7, don't worry.
Okay. Okay. Is it possible to determine from the number of brethren per lodge who attended this in future? Well, we have a record of those attending. So we're looking at issuing. If you finish all 12, I'm sorry, all webinars in April, we're looking at issue to recognize that we're looking at issuing certificates of participation. Okay, so thanks for that. On the legend of permanence, can you please comment on the edict carrying the gavel at all times instead of respectfully leaving it at the master's table? Like I said, the brethren confirmed this at an annual communication. That edict, which I understand that's the most worshipful Tolentino's edict, which highlights the importance of the gavel, it was confirmed by the brethren. So you're required to do that, to follow that edict now without innovation. Okay. Will face masks and face shields be a standard feature of ritual? No. That is only because of the current pandemic. We shouldn't be doing that. Okay. When the pandemic is over, they will obviously not be a part of, they're really not central to ritual. They're there for safety considerations. Philippine Fraternal Order of Eagles. Well, they could be a form of pseudo-masonry if they borrowed some. And I mean that in not in a positive or a negative way. Because a lot of Freemasonry is now in the public domain, clearly it's been used by many organizations. Okay, Grand Lodge of China, which under the UGLE website, it mentions a Grand Lodge of China. Is it included as Chinese Mason? The Grand Lodge of China that the UGLE recognizes is the Grand Lodge of China, which the Grand Lodge of the Philippines, is the daughter Grand Lodge. That's our daughter Grand Lodge, which the UGLE recognizes. Okay? That's based in Taiwan. The UGLE recognizes it because the UGLE recognizes that we created it from our lodges. They, with permission, they formed the Grand Lodge of China. What about Chinese Masons? Well, if you go into Tondo, you will see actually that there are some buildings there that are... that they have this, you know, these signs of Chinese Masons. Their rituals are nothing like us. Okay, so they're not. They're actually they're pseudo Masons in the sense that they don't actually borrow a ritual except our name. Okay, on the website, UGLE features women Freemasons. Do they accept it to be regular? No, they acknowledge that the UGLE acknowledges women Freemasons exist, but they are not, they are called irregular Masons because they are not regular Freemasons. Okay, so those who say they are women Freemasons, they may practice a philosophy similar to ours. Because of that, if you look at the spectrum of Masonic affiliations, they're clearly not pseudo Masons or fake Masons, and they're clearly not continental Freemasons. They are co-Masons, but they are not regular Freemasons because they cannot follow the 8 principles of Grand Lodge jurisdictions that we have. But like for the UGLE, they exist. Okay, so they exist. Okay, may I ask your permission to share to our lodge and brethren? Of course, this will be distributed, brethren. The slides, all of it will be distributed after. We will just check for typos before we distribute them. And you can watch this again. Okay, you can watch this again in the Facebook page. What about the Knights of Rizal? Okay, you could say they're a form of pseudo Freemasonry in the sense that they borrow some forms of ritual. Apparently, we're not sure. I'm a Knight of Rizal myself, but we want to highlight they are not actually a philosophical fraternity. They are what we call a patriotic fraternity, which is different, okay? In the sense that they've been organized to specifically promote a specific aspect of Philippine national identity, which is a reverence for Rizal as our national idea hero and the ideas he perpetuates, okay? So you could say that they borrow some aspects of Freemasonry impliedly, but they're clearly not a philosophical fraternity. They are separately a patriotic fraternity. And I can say that because I'm a member. They're my third. I have a professional fraternity. I have a philosophical fraternity. I have a patriotic fraternity. I'm very proud to be a Knight of Rizal, a Knight Commander of Rizal. Okay? I have encountered a Mason under the Grand Oriente Filipino in California. How do we classify them? If they're continental Freemasons, maybe. I'm not sure because clearly we don't recognize them. It depends on, you know, after you look at the classification. What will be our role as Freemason in giving our COVID-19 vaccines to our fellow men? Part of our charity work. Why are Masonic rituals not uniform standardized across some regular Masonic jurisdictions? Again, because of how these rituals developed. They were oral for like UGLE, okay, and like many jurisdictions that formed from the UGLE directly, they were transmitted orally. Now, some jurisdictions like Australia and India, they've said, no, wait, maybe it's better if we have uniform. That's why they converted from being non-uniform to uniform jurisdictions. And that's why they ended up with Grand Lodge inspectors or Grand Lodge lecturers, okay? Do we have Prince Hall Grand Lodges recognized by the GLP? Yes, as a matter of fact, there is a Prince Hall Grand Lodge in Pampanga. That Grand Lodge is recognized by the Grand Lodge of the Philippines. Okay, so I think, wait, one more. Freemasonry does not prohibit joining other organizations, fraternities. Of course it doesn't prohibit. I'm a member of two other fraternities, my own professional fraternity from the law school, and of course the Knights of Rizal, which is a patriotic fraternity. Okay, different principles, different modes of action. We're very inclusive. Okay, there is nothing contradictory between what we teach in Freemasonry and what they teach in the Knights of Rizal. And I know that because I'm a member of both fraternities. Okay, one is philosophical, being in Freemasonry. One is patriotic, being a Knight of Rizal. There is no contradiction in beliefs. Okay, so you can join. There's no prohibition. Okay, now, what about a college fraternity that actually mga hoodlum? That contradicts our principles. Okay, you should not be going around promoting violence. Oh, then that's there. You might have a contradiction there. Okay, but that's for you to determine. Okay, so I think that concludes. Very Worshipful Dennis.
Yes, Very Worshipful.
Before maybe Very Worshipful Oliver has announced it. Before that, let me just highlight. Going forward, next month we will now repeat the cycle. The next five will be the same on the five themes as taught traditionally in our Institute of Masonic Education Studies. We'll start again with Masonic jurisprudence, and we will talk about Masonic traditional law on December 16. If you want, if you're interested in what that means, we'll see you December 16 when we talk about that, right in time for our annual anniversary celebrations. And of course, these are our webinar topics in particular for round two from December next month until hopefully, Very Worshipful Dennis and Very Worshipful Oliver and I are praying, hopefully we will finish our term in April of this year in our ANCOM, right? Very Worshipful Dennis?
Yes, correct.
Thank you very much. And again, happy birthday to Most Worshipful June this Friday. Okay.
Thank you very much. Okay. Thank you very much, Very Worshipful Teddy Calaw. Your lecture this evening is not only informative but very enriching.
Belated happy birthday as well, Very Worshipful Dennis.
Thank you. Alam mo, magkasunod kami ni Grandmaster. Sinusundan ko yung mga yapak. Okay. To each and everyone, again, a pleasant evening to all. Thank you for joining this webinar series. We always appreciate your presence. We picked to about close to 200 participants this evening. That is, again, another historic undertaking for us. We all can see and appreciate how passionate the brethren are, you know, in furthering their knowledge about the craft and being able to be somehow active amidst you know, the pandemic that we're facing right now. Again, in behalf of our Most Worshipful Grandmaster, Most Worshipful Agapito S. Juan Jr., we thank you all for joining us this evening. You made this event even more successful with your presence tonight. As you can see, naka-uniform po kami dalawa ni Very Worshipful Teddy Calaw. Kaya hindi nagpapakita si Very Worshipful Oliver Yabut kasi hindi yata naka-uniform. But in the next series, you will see we will be having a more enriching and very engaging topics. Very Worshipful Oliver, nandiyan ka pa ba? AJS? Wala na yata.
Dito pa ako, Kuya Dennis.
Any announcements that you want to share to the brethren before we close this evening's webinar?
Nabanggit na naman ni Most Worshipful Suwan yung mga dapat gawin natin ngayon linggo. Eh. So, yun lang yun. Kasi hindi ako makaano. Hindi naman ako panelist eh. Mesmerized listener ako ni Kuya Teddy.
Same. We have the same. Okay, again, yes, as we all go through after every event, fellowship follows. We share a toast to all of you this evening and enjoy the rest of the night. Thank you very much to everyone. We will see you all soon and stay safe and be well. And we wish you all a pleasant evening. Magandang gabi po sa inyo lahat. Maraming salamat. Bye-bye. Ay, thank you very much pala sa Cable Tow team. My goodness, I'm sorry.
Thank you to Cable Tow. Thank you, Kuya Dennis, Kuya Oliver. Most wishful, sir.
Cable Tow team, thank you for doing a good job. I think we have a good number of live stream followers. And they've put in a lot of interest also in what we're doing right now. Thank you very much. Salamat, Cable Tow team. Okay. So again, to all of you, magandang gabi po sa inyo lahat. Magandang gabi. Bye.